Hey everybody. So at Direct Tech Labs, we do a lot of different things with different types of AI, machine learning, and deep learning algorithms. These algorithms generate all sorts of predictions and scores about direct sellers and their customers all over the world. And we get a lot of questions from people about how does this really work? And one of the questions we get the most is about our risk score. We're generating scores for every one of your reps and every one of your customers every day. That is their likelihood that that person is in the last 30 days of their life cycle. And because we're doing this times hundreds of thousands of people every day all the way around the world, sometimes people will look at specific examples and want to understand why. Why did your algorithm pick this specific person to have a risk score of X? And so I'm going to explain to you a little bit about how this kind of stuff works so we can kind of wrap our heads around it a little bit better. So here we go. Let's imagine we've got Model Jane. Jane is a model distributor of yours. She has been on an auto ship subscription for the last 8 months. She recruited a new business recruit last month, added a new customer yesterday, and made $250 last month. I would consider her to be a kind of standard person. She's doing really well. Based on her kind of key metrics, there's no reason to assume that Jane is going anywhere, right? But Jane has a risk score of 87, which means that Distro is pretty darn sure that she's in her last 30 days of her life cycle right now. How does it do that? How does it come up with that idea when on the surface it looks like Jane is a model distributor? Well, let's go up here. We're going to start with today's data. We're going to look at all these different things about not just Jane, but qualities about her upline, qualities about her downline, and qualities about her customer. Like their sales, their recruiting numbers, their commissions, their ranks, purchases, gender, age, engagement with your emails, back office use, and whatever else a customer can give us. And all of those things, not just today, but also all of those things over time, throughout of every single day of the life cycle of every single one of these people. So you can see that this all kind of adds up to like thousands of different variables about all these people that are getting into consideration. Then what you've got to do is you've got to move now into the historical data. So now you've got a picture of what's going on with Jane and what's going on above and below and around Jane. And then you want to look at people like Jane in the past that have had similar situations going on. So we might find that this person over here matches Jane 85% in terms of their sales at this point in their life cycle. And they also matched her in terms of commission. And we've already seen maybe 10,000 people that matched Jane in like these two or three criterias in the past who also had a very high likelihood or were also in their last 30 days of leaving. Then there might be some people over here that match Jane in this case and in this case and in this case mostly, and there might have been 25,000 people like that in the past. And some other ones, there might have been 100,000 people like that in the past. And there's going to be many, many, many more other ways of kind of looking at people who were like Jane in this way and like Jane in that way and very, very similar to Jane or maybe similar in just this way or in all ways, right? And the algorithm's looking at all of those different factors and attaching a little bit of a score. So this might be 5% of the score. This might be 10% of the score. This might be 1% of the score. This might be 4% of the score. And then a whole bunch of other ones all coming up to all come together to create that profile of 87 for Jane. So when we want to turn around and we want to say to Distro, hey Distro, why did you come up with 87? Why is Jane in her last 30 days? Well, you can see that that becomes an extremely difficult question to answer because the AI is actually able to think on so many more levels than a human being can that having it explain itself, it would literally need to write you, you know, 100-page long treatise for every single person explaining all of the things that it did to come up with this score. Now, this is a problem that every AI in the world faces. The AI that's predicting your likelihood to leave Netflix has the same problem. The AI that's choosing what it's going to show you when you log into Facebook has the same problem. YouTube, Amazon, they all have the same problem. They're all looking into the future and trying to give probabilities because the future is uncertain, right? And there's all sorts of things about people that we don't know, which means that we can only be so accurate. So what these companies do is they have a way to verify the accuracy. They say, well, if I don't know exactly why, let me at least make sure that I'm right. And so you will allow our customers, and it's actually a guarantee that we provide, to independently verify that when we say that somebody's in their last 30 days, we're right generally between 80 and 90% of the time, depending on the customer, how much data, how much historical, all that kind of stuff, and getting smarter and smarter over time. And that's how these companies do it, is that you can independently verify that if I give you 10,000 people that we think are in their last 30 days, you can verify that that's actually right using historical data. But you, at the same time, you won't be able to know exactly why it's happening today. So the fact is, the value is absolutely there for us because we know that we're right so many percent of the time, but figuring out exactly why becomes a problem that is a little bit more complicated than us simple humans can understand from an AI. So I hope this is helpful in terms of how these kind of scores generally work and how overall the predictions of churn make sense. Thanks for listening.